أينما تكونوا يدرككم الموت ولو كنتم في بروج مشيدة.
Wherever you may be, death will reach you, even if you are in built up fortresses. As a certainty, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
كل نفس ذائقة الموت.
Every soul shall taste
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين إلى الجنائز In our last verse we mentioned some of the signs of a good end some of the signs of a good end And we mentioned death as a martyr, one of those signs of a good end, death as a martyr. We mentioned that martyrdom is not restricted only to the one who has been killed by the enemies in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but there are other things which also constitute martyrdom. Right? Then also, one of the things that we've mentioned regarding good death, or I think one of the things we have not mentioned yet regarding a good death is the person who dies murabit fi sabilillah. He dies murabit fi sabilillah. He goes out on a military expedition or yani to protect the boundaries. Goes out on a military expedition, or he is posted at the borders. He's posted at the borders, protecting the Muslim lands. Right? The person who dies in that state, he is a murabit, and he dies in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said regarding this, that ribatu yawmin wa layla, خَيْرٌ مِنْ صِيَامِ شَهْرٍ وَقِيَامِهِ That to make ribat for a day or a night is better than to pray for a whole month and to fast for a whole month. To make ribat, yani, protect the Muslim borders, military operation, this is better, yani, one day or a night like this is better for him than a whole month of salah and fasting. وَإِنْ مَاتَ جَرَى عَلَيْهِ عَمَلُهُ الَّذِي كَانَ يَعْمَلُهُ وَأُجْرِي عَلَيْهِ رِزْقُهُ وَأَمِنَ الْفِتَنِ And if he dies in that state, his actions that he used to do will continue for him. Will be continuously rewarded for the actions that he used to do. So even though he has died, it is still being rewarded as if he is acting, as if he is doing أَعْمَالُ صَالِحَةً And His sustenance will come to him. His sustenance will come to him. You know, and remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says regarding the shuhada who died in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, بَلْ هُمْ أَحْيَاء عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ بَلْ أَحْيَاء They are alive with their Lord يُرْزَقُونَ Receiving their sustenance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also this person will be saved from the fitan. Will be saved from the trials and tribulation of the grave and of death. So, if a person dies in the state, then obviously, this is a good death. This is a good death. If a person dies, murabitan fi sabilillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala. Then another good death, and a sign of a good death, is al-maut ala al-amal salih. Dying upon a righteous deed. Dying upon doing a righteous deed or upon fulfilling a righteous deed. So the person does something good and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes his ruh. You know, for example, he goes to the masjid for Jumu'ah or for Salah and after praying Allah ta'ala takes his soul. Or whilst praying Allah ta'ala takes his soul. Or the person he goes to the poor people with charity And he goes and he gives it, and on his way back, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes his soul. So he dies upon a righteous deed. This is the last deed that he did. Right, so if the last deed that a person did is a righteous deed, then this is a sign of a good death. And that person is guaranteed Jannah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من قال لا إله إلا الله ابتغاء وجه الله ختم له بها دخل الجنة. Whoever says لا إله إلا الله, seeking with it the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only, and this is his final act, he will enter the Jannah. ختم له بها, يعني his actions are sealed with it. This is his last act. And then he will enter the Jannah. وَمَنْ صَامَ يَوْمًا ابْتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ اللَّهِ خُتِمَ لَهُ بِهَا دَخْلَ الْجَنَّةِ. And whoever fasts a day, seeking only the face of Allah, and it is his last action, he will enter the Jannah. وَمَنْ تَصَدَّقَ بِصَدَقَةٍ ابْتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ اللَّهِ خُتِمَ لَهُ بِهَا دَخْلَ الْجَنَّةِ. And whoever gives a charity, seeking only the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is his final action, then he will enter the Jannah. The person will enter the Jannah. So all these, and it shows us that dying upon a righteous action or a righteous deed is the sign of a good death. Another good death is to be killed by an oppressive or tyrant ruler. And a Muslim, a mu'min, who is amiran bil ma'roof, nahiyan anil munkar, who orders with the good and prohibits the evil. And so the leader, a tyrant, oppressive ruler, kills him because of that, then that person, yani, he has died a good death, and he is a great shaheed. He is a great shaheed. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Sayyidu shuhada, Sayyidu shuhada, the leader of the, yani, the martyrs, and from the best of martyrs, Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. This is uncle Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Wa rajulun qama ila imamin ja'ir, فَأَمَرَهُ وَنَهَاهُ فَقَتَلَهُ. And a man who goes to a tyrant ruler and he orders him with good and he prohibits him from evil, and so that ruler kills him. So this person is from, yani, the Sayyidu Shuhada, is from the leaders of the Sadatu Shuhada, from the leaders of the martyrs. You know, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned him with the likes of Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So these are signs, as we mentioned, of a good death. Then when the person has died, then to speak good about that person, if it is true, is encouraged and it is recommended. To speak good about him, and if it's true, that it can't be a person of batil, a person of falsehood, a liar, a thief, and then you, when he dies, you say, mashallah, I was a good man. Or the person is a disbeliever in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he dies and says, mashallah, I was a good man. No, it must be a reality. That when they praise him, and they mention good about him, and it is a reality, then this witness is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The witness is accepted by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enter in Jannah on account of it. Allah ta'ala will enter into the Jannah on account of it. Now, there's a number of a hadith regarding this. From it is the hadith of Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a janazah pass by him. مر برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم جنازة فأثني عليها خيرا. And the people mentioned good about the person who died. The people mentioned good about the person. وتتابعت الألسن بالخير. And their tongues, yani, the people kept saying, as the janazah went on, the people were still mentioning good about that person. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَجَبَتْ 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 وَجَبَتْ. It has become compulsory. It has become compulsory. Right? And then another janazah came by. Caused by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَأُثْنِيَ عَلَيْهِ شَرَّا. And the people mentioned bad about this person. And as the janazah went, they kept saying bad things still about him. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَجَبَتْ وَجَبَتْ وَجَبَتْ. It's become compulsory, compulsory, compulsory. So then the Sahaba, they said, Ya Rasulullah, this janazah went by, and you said, wajabat, wajabat, wajabat. And people praised it with good. And then another janazah went by, and they mentioned bad about it, and you said, wajabat, wajabat, wajabat. فَقَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ هَذِي, يعني the first janazah, أَثْنَيْتُمْ عَلَيَا خَيْرًا. You praised it with good. You praised it with good. You mentioned good about it. The people carried that dead person. They went by with him. The other people, they mentioned good about him. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَجَبَتْ لَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. Jannah has become compulsory for him. And the other one, وَثَانِيَا أَثْنَيْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ شَرَّا. You mentioned bad things about him. Person at the janazah that came by the second time, the people said bad things about him. He was a bad person, he was an evil person. You know how terrible he was with his deen. So, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, وَجَبَتْ لَهُ النَّارِ. The hellfire has become compulsory for him. And he said, الْمَلَائِكَةُ شُهَدَاءُ اللَّهِ فِي السَّمَاءِ وَأَنْتُمْ شُهَدَاءُ اللَّهِ فِي الْأَرْضِ. See, the malaika, they are the witnesses of Allah in the heavens. And you are the witnesses of Allah on the earth. You are the witnesses of Allah on the earth. So when you bore witness for the good of that person, Allah Ta'ala accepted your witness. Right? And when the people, the Muslims, bore witness that that was a bad person, Allah Ta'ala accepted their witness. Oh, subhanallah. So, another matter that is important regarding this, the people who are praising the deceased, they should be people who actually knew him. People who lived with him, khalata, who mixed with him, who had interactions with him. Not someone who never knew him, and then the janazah comes, and he hears someone else say something, and he just says the same. Because that is not the reality. You might praise the person with things that the person never did. You know, so this is for those who actually knew the mayit, and it is whether the praise is muwafaqa lil haqiqa, the praise is in conformity with the reality of the person. Another thing regarding this, some people believed that this was only for the Sahaba, that the Nabi said, Antum shuhada'ullah fil ard, you are Allah's witnesses on the earth. However, there is another narration, another hadith, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said specifically, Al-mu'minuna shuhada'ullahi fil ard. The believers are the witnesses of Allah on the earth. And the mu'minun, also not any person. The mu'minun, the true believers. You know, those who they are upon righteousness, upon the correct belief system, upon the correct methodology. The believers, they are Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala's witnesses on the earth. So when they praise someone that has died with good, then that witness is accepted. And when they mention bad about this person, that witness is also accepted. In another narration, it mentions an amount of witnesses. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there is no Muslim who dies, and four of the believers, they bear witness for him, that he was a good, pious person. Except that Allah Ta'ala accepts their witness for him. Four people. When Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was asked about it in his time, in his khilafah, when somebody came by and they mentioned good about it, Umar radiallahu anhu said, wajabat, wajabat. Like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. So they asked him, why did you say this? And he said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said this. And he said that there's no Muslim For whom four believers be witness of good, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will accept their witness for that person. Right? Then the person asked him, so what if it is three? So he said, even three. He asked him, what if it is two? He said, even two. Even two. Right? Now we know in Islam, for example, when you must bring witnesses, you must bring two Muslim witnesses. Two just Muslim witnesses. So the hadith of mentioning four, this might have been before the revelation of bringing two witnesses. So Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said even two is sufficient. Right? Even two is sufficient. Although the wording of the hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said four. Right? Tayyib. In another narration, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that the malaika, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has malaika, who speak the truth upon the tongue of certain believers. Allah ta'ala has malaika who utter the truth upon the tongue of certain believers. So when they be witness for a person with good, then Allah ta'ala accepts that witness. Allah ta'ala accepts it. Right? So this also indicates, you know, the malaika can't lie. The malaika can't say something contrary to the reality. Right? They only do what Allah ta'ala has commanded them and created them for. So they speak only the truth. Right? So in this case, it is necessary that what you say about the person is reality and true. You can't make up something now. Right? Thinking you want to give the person Jannah. Right? In fact, a bid'ah was introduced into Islam for this reason. A bid'ah was introduced. In some of the Arab countries, you have after the Salatul Janaza people turning around. The Imam turns around and he says, with what do you bear witness for this mayyit? With what do you bear witness for the mayyit? After the Salatul Janaza. For what do you bear witness for the mayyit? Then the people say, Salih, Khair, or something like this. This is a bid'ah. This is a bid'ah. Because all the people, they know what the reason is for this, and that they are now trying to give good witness for this person, so that he can go to Jannah, right? But so people who don't even know him, they say, Salih. How do you know? You know, so this is not meant that you must just say for everyone. Mm. You know, wallahi, sometimes a Muslim dies, and no one has any good to say about him. He was a fasiq, a fajir, a transgressor, a sinner, a zalim, an oppressor. You know, he used to rob people, hurt people, do whatever wrong things. So when he dies, the people are like, Alhamdulillah. You know, so now it's not for you to say, you know what, he was a very good person. Because you're lying. You know, so if you praise a person with good, it is the good that you know. It is a reality and a truth. Imagine you say, a person was a mubtadi', an innovator, and then when he dies, you say, MashaAllah, mutamassik bi sunnah. Person of the sunnah. He's an innovator. SubhanAllah. Right, so you must speak the truth. قولوا قولا سديدا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولاً سديدا. Or you believe, fear Allah and speak a word that is true and just. True and just. So this is the reality, that when the people be witness for him with good, and it is a reality, then Allah Ta'ala accepts the witness for him. As for the action of some people that saying, you know, what do you bear witness for the person, and the people in the masjid saying, no, he was good or whatever, this is a bid'ah. This is an innovation. Not found at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or his khulafa or rashidun, or those who followed them in righteousness of the tabi'un and the a'immatul deen. The next matter, also with regards to when a person dies, and we see this a lot. A person dies and some natural event takes place. You know, some event with regards to nature, like for example an earthquake, or an eclipse, or it rains a lot, storms and the thunder, you know. And then people, they say, Subhanallah, this was a great man who died. Why? Because, you know, it was raining, or because it was an eclipse, or because of something. And this is not the reality. The entire universe is at the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these things only happen with Allah's command. Not because someone died. Not because someone died. So look at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when his son Ibrahim alayhi salam died. When his son Ibrahim, when he died, and there was an eclipse. So the people, they said, يعني الشمسو لا ينخسر, the moon, the sun will not eclipse, إلا لموت عظيم, except for the death of a very great individual. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he addressed the people and he said, أما بعد, يا أيها الناس, he said to proceed, O people, كان الناس يقولون في الجاهلية, the people used to say in Jahiliyyah that if the person died and the moon or sun eclipses, that it only eclipses for the death of a very great person. Says this is from where? From Jahiliyyah. It's not from Islam. So he said, "Wa innahuma ayatani min ayatillah." The sun and the moon eclipsing, these are two signs from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا ينكسفان لموت أحد ولا لحياتي. It doesn't eclipse for the death of anyone nor for the life of anyone. وإنما يخوف الله به عباده. But it is that which Allah Ta'ala puts fear into His slaves with. Allah Ta'ala makes the slaves see the greatness of Allah so that they fear Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala can cause that sun to stay away. But Allah Ta'ala has the power to do this. So this is signs with which Allah Ta'ala puts fear into the people. So he said, فَإِذَا رَأَيْتُم مِّن ذَلِكَ شَيْئًا. If you see anything of that, فَفْزَعُوا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Then hasten towards remembrance of Allah. وَإِسْتِغْفَارِهِ. And seeking His forgiveness. وَالصَّلَاةِ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ. And establish the salah in the masajid. And he also mentioned even giving charity. And when you see an eclipse, then you must hasten towards doing something of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because you don't know. You don't know what can be the outcome of it. Only Allah ta'ala knows. You know, so this is something which Allah ta'ala puts fear into the believers with. It is not something that has to do with the death of any person. Same with earthquakes, same with rain, or wind, or anything else. These are all the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is under the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't rain because someone died. Nor does the earth shake because someone died. Nor does the thunder strike because someone died. Right? This is all from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So remember, when people say this is from the matters of jahiliyyah. From the matters of jahiliyyah. Inshallah ta'ala, we begin now with the theory of ghusl al-mayyit. The theory of washing the mayyit. And this is obviously before the practical. Right, so we're dealing with the theory on washing the mayyit. Now the first thing that we should know, إذا مات المايت وجب على طائفة من الناس أن يغسلوه. When a mayyit dies, it is wajib upon a group of people, upon a group of the believers, upon a group of the Muslims, that they should wash him. If he's a Muslim and he dies, then it is wajib upon a group of the Muslims. In other words, it is not wajib on the whole ummah. Everyone can't wash him, but somebody has to wash him. So it is a fardun kifaya. فرض كفاية إذا قام به البعض سقط عن الآخرين. When some of them establish the obligation, it falls away from others. Responsibility falls away from others. And they need to hasten with that. They need to hasten with washing the mayit. Remember, we took the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that hasten, asri'u bil janaza. Hasten with the janaza. Hasten with the janaza. Don't delay. Don't delay it. So the sooner we can, the better. We should wash the mayit and prepare him as soon as possible. Now in our times and in our situation, sometimes the mayit dies in the hospital, and sometimes the government, they obligate that an autopsy must be done. In this case, if we can't escape it, then yani, we wash the mayit as soon as that is done. We don't delay longer than that. But in the case where we can avoid this, we try and avoid it at all costs. We try and avoid it at all costs. Wallahi, we try to deal with the doctors, we try to, you know, to deal with whoever is in charge, whoever is at the morgue, just to get the body of a Muslim without them cutting him. You know, we negotiate with him, we try everything. And if sometimes, alhamdulillah, we get away with it. And sometimes we don't. You know, sometimes the case of death, you know, it is a special case, I don't know what was the cause, and things like this, and then they insist upon an autopsy. And in that case, our hands are tied. In that case, we can't do anything. Right? But then we need to hasten with washing this person as soon as we can get that body. Right? And we cannot delay any further than that. Some people, already that is a delay. The person dies in the hospital. Then there's a delay. Then the person goes to the mortuary, and there's another delay. And then the person is released from the mortuary, and then they themselves still delay further. You know, this is not permissible. It's not permissible to do this. Rather, we should hasten with the preparation of the mayyit. As for it being wajib, and this is because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amara bihi. He ordered with it. Wal amr yaqtadi al wujub. And we know in the usul of fiqh that a command necessitates what? Obligation. If the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded something, it means it is wajib. Illa ma dalla dalilun ala istihbabihi. Except if there is a proof to show it is only recommended. You know, so if the Nabi gives an order, it means that thing is wajib unless there is a proof to indicate it is only recommended and not wajib. So as far as the washing is concerned, then we know that this is wajib. Because Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered with it, and there is no dalil that shows it is only recommended. Right, so it is wajib. Remember we did the hadith of the person who was on Hajj, and his beast threw him down, his camel threw him down, and he broke his neck. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say? He said, اغسلوه بماء وسدر وكفنوه في ثوبين. He said, wash him with water and cedar, and kafan him, shroud him with his two garments. In other words, this is a command from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Likewise, when his daughter Zainab, Radiyallahu ta'ala anha wa alayhi salam, and when she died, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the woman, اغسلناها ثلاثا أو سبعا أو أكثر من ذلك إذا رأيتنا ذلك. He said, wash her three times or five times or seven times or more if you see the need for it. You see the need for washing her more than three times, and wash her more than three times. Right? But he ordered them with washing her. Right? So this is a command from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that indicates that it is wajib. طيب. From the things that we need to observe in accordance with these ahadith, when the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned the washing of his daughter, he said, wash thrice or five times or seven times. Right? In accordance with the need. In accordance with the need. So we have to wash the mayit at least three times. The ghusl, we make a washing of at least three times, because it began with three. He said, wash out 3 times, or 5, or 7. Right, so he begins with 3. And he observes witr in that, and even numbers. He doesn't say 3 or 4. He says 3 or 5 or 7. Right? So it must be an uneven number. It must be an uneven number of washes that we give the mayyit. Right? And also that we accompany or we mix with this a wash with cedar. Now we may not have cedar, the low tree leaves which is crushed. Right? So some of the ulama, minhum Sheikh al-Albani wa Sheikh bin Baz wa ghayru min al-ulama, they say, so use something that is used for the same purpose. The purpose of cedar was to clean the body. The purpose of cedar was to clean the body. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that wash her with water and cedar. Wash with water and cedar, in other words, mix some cedar into the water. So we can also use some soap. We can also use some soap because the purpose of the cedar is not for the scent. The cedar is for the cleaning. Right? So we use some soap. Right? And some of the mughassilun, the people who wash, they recommend that you use the green soap.
Sunlight.
They recommend you use the green soap. Right? And because this is not very strong and doesn't have a very strong chemical makeup, so for the skin and so on, right? So you use this in the place of cedar if we don't have cedar, right? The last time that I found cedar here was when some people brought it for me, you know. So I don't know whether we get cedar around here. You know, some people actually brought it to me from Saudi. So I don't know if we can get the cedar, like if it's easily accessible around here. The low tree leaves, and they crush it, right? So we mix the water with, yani, some cedar or whatever we can use in the place of cedar. Another thing to note is that in the last washing, we will mix the water with something else, which is camphor, and that we have. Right, we use the camphor. Yeah, we get the blocks with the set. If you go and you get the set of the kafan, they also give you camphor with it. Right, or you can buy it. So in the last mix of the water with the last washing, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, اجعل في آخرهن, make in the last washing some camphor. And the reason for putting it in the last washing is so that smell remains. Camphor has a very great effect on the mayit and on the body. It is cool. It's one of its reasons, one of the wisdoms behind it. Also, the smell, right, is very strong but yet pleasant. It's not a bad smell, and it can cover up even an odor which is being emitted from the body. Also, that smell repels insects. It also repels insects. So there's various reasons that have been mentioned for using camphor with the last wash, yani, so that we don't wash it away. You know, we don't wash the camphor away. Right. Another thing that we note with regards to the washing is, if it is a lady, to untie the hair. To untie the hair. And if it is a man, that we make sure that we wash the hair properly. Right? That we wash, like when you make ghusl, to wash till the water goes to your skin, right? So this is one thing that is important. For the ladies, after the washing of the hair, they should make it into 3 braids or plaits. And make it into 3 braids or plaits. If I go too fast and you miss something, just tell me to stop or just to repeat. So with the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ordered the woman to wash her. And they washed her, and they loosened the hair, and then they made it into 3 plaits. And they said 2 on the side and 1 on top. And they put this behind her. Put this down behind her back or behind her head. Right. So this is for the ladies. Another thing to note with the ghusl is beginning with the places of wudu when doing the ghusl. Now, obviously, what comes before that? You're going to begin doing the ghusl with the places of wudu. So what comes before it? Istibra and istinja. Istibra and istinja. Istibra will be that before you actually start with the ghusl, remember when you go make ghusl, the order for you is to wash your private parts first. Right? So when you are ghusling the mayit, then the first thing you do, you first release any excess of wind or even najasa, urine or stool. That might be in the passage that will come out due to movement. So you release it first. This is done by pressing softly down onto the stomach of the mayit, yani whilst throwing water. You press down and you throw the water so that this can be removed, that this washes off and washes away from the body of the mayit. Right. So then he makes the istinja and then he begins with the, like we're mentioning now, with the places of wudu. He begins with the places of wudu. Right. Now, when we begin with the places of wudu, obviously you start just like with wudu, with the right side and then the left side. Right, right side, left side. Like a complete wudu. Right? You're going to give the mayit a complete wudu. Another thing to remember is that if the mayit is a male, that those who wash him or enter the room must be males. If the mayit is a male, a man, then men must wash men. Right? If it is a female, females must wash females. Except for the exception of husband and wife. This is the exception. The exception of husband and wife. Now, regarding this, there is one weak statement that I want to clarify. There is the statement that if the husband dies, because the wife is still under iddah, there is still a connection and she may wash her husband. But when the wife dies, then there is no more connection between her and her husband. And so he can't wash his wife. This is false. This is a false statement. Right? The husband has the most right to wash his wife. He has the most right. He knows his wife intimately. So he has the most right to wash her. Likewise, the wife has the most right to wash her husband. Remember, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came into the house, and Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha complained. And she said, wa ra'sa, wa ra'sa. Oh my head, oh my head. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, bal wa ra'sa. No, oh my head, oh my head. And then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if you die before me, Aisha, you know, if you die before me, I would wash you, and I would kafan you, and I will pray over you. Says this to his wife, I will wash you myself, and I will kafan you, and I will pray over you. Right, subhanallah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would he say, I will do this if this was not permissible? No, he wouldn't say this. This is an indication that this is the right of the husband to do. Likewise, look at Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she described the ghusl of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he died, and they washed him. Then she thought and she said afterwards, لو استدبرت من أمري ما استقبلت. And if I only delayed the matter a bit, you know, in other words, if I could go back to what happened, you know, then no one would wash Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam illa nisa'ahu, except his wives. I wouldn't let anyone else wash him. His wives would have washed him. But at that time, subhanAllah, the Muslims were in a state of panic. You know, in a state of chaos. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most beloved, the Prophet, the leader, the everything, subhanAllah. Leader, politically, religiously, military, everything, subhanAllah. He had died. So, you know, matters were not as easy. And so no one, you know, everyone was not very how can I say, they were not at the height of these sentences at that time, you know, because of the calamity that befell them. So, likewise, with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and this is something that brings us to another point, that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam died, and they wanted to wash him, everyone was there. They were confused. They said, we did not know. هل نجلد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من ثيابه أو نغسل وعليه ثيابه. They said, they didn't know, should we now undress Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, take off his clothes, or should we wash him with his clothes on him? And the hadith, it says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala covered everyone in the room with sleep.
Wow.
Everyone fell asleep. To the extent that there wasn't one person in the room except that his chin was on his chest.
Wow.
His chin was on his chest. Then they all heard a voice from one of the corners of the room, and no one knew who said it. Allah Akbar. They heard a voice from the corner of the room, and they are all in the room, and no one knows who is speaking. And the voice said to them that, wash Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his clothes on him. Wash him with his clothes on him. You cannot undress Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she says, they washed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by throwing the water over his qamis and rubbing on top of it. Rubbing on top of the clothes, on top of the qamis. Right? And no one took off the clothes from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the most modest of this ummah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the most modest person. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the person who was the most preserving of his own honor and his own shame. So it is not for anyone to undress him. You know, subhanallah. So Allah ta'ala, he covered them with sleep, and he made a call and announce unto them. Whether it was a malak, Allah a'lam. Allah knows best. But someone announced that they must wash Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his clothes on him. So this is astar li awratihi wa irdihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is more preserving of his awra and his honor. It's more preserving of his awra and his honor. So one of the things that we need to take heed of when performing ghusl of a mayyit is to never uncover his awra. Must never uncover the awra of the mayyit. It is his honor, it is his shame, his modesty that we must protect as Muslims. We must protect, we must be very protective over it. Harming a Muslim when he is dead is the same as harming him when he is alive. The same as harming him as when he is alive. So we need to treat this body with respect and with dignity. Now,
how do you get these najasat and stuff out, pressing on the stomach without uncovering him?
Without uncovering him. Tayyib. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he clarified to us, what is the awrah? He clarified to us, what is the awrah? He said, ma bayna surah wa rukba awrah. What is between the navel and the knees and including it is awrah. It is awrah. Right. So you never have to uncover the navel or right down in order to press on the person's stomach. And the water you are throwing on top of the covering. You know, so we don't use a very thick covering. We use a covering that yani protects and conceals the aura of the person, but without stopping the water. Doesn't stop the water from flowing through. So you press on the stomach when you lean up the mayit in a almost sitting position, like not completely up, but you bring him up and you press out the najasa, yani by pressing you make istibra if there is najasa and wings. And when you do this, you take the water and you throw it on top of the covering, you know, to wash away the najasa. And you do this as long as there is najasa flowing with the water. As long as there is najasa flowing away with the water, which you will see and you will smell, then you keep doing that until he is free of that. If there is a problem afterwards, with the person maybe having more excretion, then, you know, we will do this though, but then you can use some of the cotton wool and you use it as something to stop the flow of the najasa coming. Right? So this, inshallah ta'ala, we will do. But remember what is important from this is that the awra of the mayyit must not be uncovered. For the men, from the navel to the knees and including it. Remember, and including it. From the navel to the knee doesn't mean it must be above the knee. In other words, it must be over the knee. And it must be over the navel. Right? It must be over the navel. So you mustn't uncover that area. Right? We must try our best to keep that area protected at all times. For the woman, then the awra, you know, the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, Al-Mar'atu awra. The woman is awra. Right? The woman is awra. But now the woman is amongst women. So what can be uncovered of the woman now is yani mahallatu zina, the places of beautification. Because when woman is amongst women, it is allowed for her to show these places. Right? It's allowed for her to show these places. So the hair is uncovered, the face is uncovered, the neck is uncovered, right? Up onto the top of the chest is uncovered. Yani the top, and then the sheet comes from here down. On the top of the chest, the nahar, yani here's the nahar, right? Here's the nahar, and then here's the top of the chest. So from here, the sheet goes down, right? And it goes all the way down to the lower part or the half of the shin. The half of the shin, right? That is what must be covered of the woman, because the woman is awra. Woman is awra. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, لَا يَنْظُرُ الرَّجُلْ إِلَىٰ أَوْرَةِ الرَّجُلْ وَلَا الْمَرْأَ إِلَىٰ أَوْرَةِ الْمَرْأَ. He said, a man does not look at the aura of another man, nor a woman at the aura of another woman. So you see some of this ignorance that is widespread amongst us, when women think they are alone, that they expose themselves. Even their aura. Right? They are not allowed to expose their aura. Even if it is amongst women. Even if it is amongst women. Likewise, men. We are not kuffar. We don't ask for some more months. Doesn't work like that. Al-haya'u min al-iman. Shyness is from iman. A person must protect his awrah. And no man can look at the awrah of another man. Right? Nor can a woman look at the awrah of another woman. So this must be protected. And it must not be uncovered throughout the ghusl. Throughout the ghusl, it must be protected. When we take off the clothes, we take off the clothes without uncovering the awrah. Right? If it is easy to remove it without cutting, we remove it without cutting. Right? If it is difficult to remove it, we cut it off. I'm going to demonstrate that slow, inshallah ta'ala, how to cut it and just pull it out very easily without uncovering the awrah of the mayit. The aura must be protected at all times. Another thing regarding the ghusl, very important. Whatever you see on the mayit, you must not expose it to anyone. Whatever you see on the mayit, if you see signs of a bad death, for example, sometimes the person, and wallahi I've witnessed, you come, you need to make ghusl of the mayit, and you can hardly recognize this person. Not because his face was damaged in an accident or anything like this, but because of the darkness, because of the look on the face of that person. Subhanallah, this type of thing, you don't go and tell the family or anyone else. No, subhanallah, you must protect him, you must preserve him. You know, whatever you saw, you must conceal it. You must conceal it. But if you see any sign of good, that you must convey. That you must convey. Especially to the relatives. The relatives who are now sad, because they lost this person, and you see, subhanallah, maybe you knew him, and you see the nur on this person, and you see this beautiful, subhanallah, wallahi, this we've also, we've seen, we've experienced, alhamdulillah, there's mughassilin here, there's people who have washed many bodies, and you see this sometimes, you see the signs of a good end, and this type of information you convey to the family. You say, MashaAllah, look at the nur upon his face. You know, look at how contented this person seems. You know, the appearance of this person is good. I saw nothing but good. This is the type of information you can convey. Right? As for anything negative or bad, it is haram for you to convey it. Right? It is haram for you to tell anyone, especially the relatives of the deceased. Another matter with regards to the yani to the ghusl is the ghusl of the muhrim that we mentioned, the person in the haram. The person in the haram we don't use perfume, anything perfumed. We don't use perfume on that person. Right? You can use the siddur because the purpose of the siddur is what? To clean. Right? And the siddur it's not a strong smelling perfume. But we don't use any perfume on that person. Not hanut or any other type of perfume. Right? Because the person is in the haram. Right? He's in the haram. And also we know, as we know, this will come with a kafan, that we don't cover his head and his face. We leave that open. Right? Because he's going to be resurrected. Yawm al-qiyamati. Mulabbiyan in a state of tawbiyah, inshaAllah ta'ala. Another matter, the shaheed, shaheedul ma'arakah, shaheed of the battlefield. Is he washed? He is not washed. The shaheed of the battlefield, he is buried just as he is. He's buried just as he is, with the clothes, with the blood on, just like that we bury him. We don't wash off the blood. Right? We just cover him and we bury him. Right? And this is because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said he will be resurrected yawm al-qiyamah with the blood still flowing. Right? And the color will be the color of blood, but the smell will be the smell of musk. So this is from the great yani fada'il, virtues of the shaheed. The shaheed al-ma'araka, the one who dies on the battlefield. We mentioned the husband and the wife that can whistle one another. Then also, if a child is very young, a child is small, right? Even if it is a boy, then the mother can wash him. If it is a boy, a tiflun, a baby, then the mother may wash the boy, right? Even though it is a boy. Right? Normally, the father will not wash the daughter. Father will not wash the daughter and the mother will not wash the son. Right? But if it is a baby, then it is permitted for the mother to wash a daughter or a son. Right? This is permitted for her to do. Inshallah ta'ala, there are some more points that we are going to mention, and before we do the practical ghusl inshallah ta'ala, and we will continue with those points in our next dars inshallah ta'ala, and we will suffice with this for tonight. Subhanaka wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad, walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.